So the topic is also about artificial intelligence. And Elon Musk and Mark Zuckerberg have had recently very interesting conversation about that. They claim that artificial intelligence is really dangerous and eventually it's going to kill all of us. But before it happens, I would like to tell you how we could use it in designing smarter architecture. Welcome, my name is Judyta Cichocka. Today I'm representing Prometheus Support, a Berlin-based startup. We are trying to implement artificial intelligence in the construction sector based on artificial intelligence. Have you ever thought about your death? How your funeral is going to look like? How many people are going to come? What atmosphere is going to be like? So Toyota, one of the most famous Japanese architects, thought about it. He wanted to create a special place for Japanese people to say goodbye to their family and friends in an atmosphere of mystery and dignity. And he wanted to create this beautiful floating roof for this crematorium. So he came up with some ideas how it could look like. He sketched some options. Then he called his engineer Matsuo Sasaki and asked, okay, what can we do with that? And Matsuo said, okay, we could go with this shape. We need just 20 centimeters thick reinforced concrete shell and we could build it. So it was 2003 and they built finally in 2006. But could it have been done better, actually? Like today we have experimental tools and we could generate thousands, like not millions of different options and how to choose the best one. So in terms of this project, it was already analyzed also by colleagues from Roberto Pignala many times and also by me. In this particular case, we have this number of solutions. I don't know if there's even a name for this number. So if you want to say how much time it's going to take to calculate all these options, that is called brute force in optimization jargon. So for human, if I have the ability, capability to assess how performs this roof, and I need 1 minute for that. It's really infinite time. If I have a super fast computer that calculates this in 1 microsecond, the whole thing, the element analysis that is school, we need more than 10,000 years. And this is the answer why we need artificial intelligence to help us to find the solutions. But this is not the only reason. Also, the nature of architectural design problems. Okay, there is a literature behind that, I will skip it. Like, in short, like architectural design problems are difficult optimization problems because not only because the number of solutions, sometimes they are over-constrained. They have like holes in the landscape, they are badly formulated, we don't know if there is any answer possible, and we are humans and we somehow sometimes we have barriers to discover the best solution because we have something in our mind that this should be something like that. And this is the other reason we need artificial intelligence to help us to discover the best performing solutions. So let's have a look, quick look what actually techniques we have on the table right now. And what is artificial intelligence, like at the core? From the definition, this is computer science branch on the border of these three sciences like cognitive science, artificial psychology, and neuroscience. I really like this definition that says that this is a cross-disciplinary field that develops and investigates systems that operate or act intelligently. And now it's a question for you. Based on this, how do you think which answer is the best for artificial intelligence? What it is? So it's like humans or it's rational? It implies some contradictory about that we are not rational, but actually this is the definition from Russell and Norwick that actually this is 4 categories of artificial intelligence. And what I like the most about all these definitions is that this is basically about intelligent agents. And what these intelligent agents do try to improve the chance of success. And this is about, this is general topic, like this is general view on artificial intelligence. So, we have a lot of like categorization branches, but I would like to just concentrate on the computational intelligence and these three of those: evolutionary algorithms, swarm intelligence, and artificial neural networks that was already mentioned in the previous presentation. So basically, I really like this because when you want to see the difference between all these categories, you could just observe how much time they need to learn. So evolutionary algorithms need eons, generations to learn how to improve the chance of success. Like swarm intelligence, all these algorithms behind, they need a time frame of experience, like they flocking, they are schooling, they are talking to each other, how they could improve. And artificial neural networks is based on milliseconds, so the actions in our brain. If we have a look to the software, like what's already implemented, what you could use to use artificial intelligence in design. Okay, that's table from March. It's dominated by EC, EC, EC. And when you go to the conference, probably design symposium modeling is gonna also confirm that. Still, most of people use Galapagos and EC. And that's it. Okay, there are new solvers appeared just last month. And my research is about implementing new methods that transform swarm intelligence, about particle swarm optimization, and to compare if it's worth or not. Because no one knows, yes, like which algorithm is going to be the best actually, yeah, to which problem. So the method itself is very simple. It was invented in the 90s by Kennedy Abraham. They wanted to simulate how the birds flock, and they claimed that by the chance discover it optimizes actions. So the pseudo code, like it's very simple. Now it's implemented in a small plugin for Grasshopper, dog-mounted. Of course it was tested, so I could tell you on toy problems, it was 20 times faster than Galapagos and other evolutionary-based solvers. But of course it was also tested on real-life problem because we want to see what we could achieve, and this was complex design problem with 85 parameters, so the problem was 85 dimensional, if you could imagine that. And we tested that on this problem, it was already elaborated before, and again, it turned out that in all the tests, like PSO was able to discover feasible solutions when all the other couldn't. And I could just go on and go on this research, but I think it's not that exciting. Exciting is what can we do with that? What can we really win? So I made a small model for myself. Like after whole night of optimization of this rule structure, I was like, okay, what's the result? Maybe in 8 hours that was better, or octopus is better, I don't know. I opened the results and the super eye was like on the 1 centimeter displacement, maximum one. So it means I could reduce the thickness of the shell by 8 centimeters, and it gives the same performance of the shell. It gives 40 seconds of material. But it's not just material, yes? It's production of material, transportation of material, it's a lower construction time, and so on and so on. Is it smarter? I don't know. But at the end, this is architecture. It's not about just performance, it's not about aesthetics, but it has so many features, like we also want water to come out of this roof and all these things. So all design involves conflicting objectives. That's why we need a multi-objective optimizer. And I also asked architects worldwide if they need optimization, and they confirmed my view. That was really nice. That convinced also German government to give us some grants to develop this thing that is called Monarca, and it's multi-objective optimizer based on particle swarm, multi-objective particle swarm optimizer. Okay, what it does, basically it takes all the objectives and gives us the correct one. So the solution that can't be improved in any of the objectives, not decreasing the other objectives. And this is what we do now, like in the company. We take like client's input project, we try to optimize it and then deliver just catalog of solutions. Because it's hard to like, for them, go from scratch. Sometimes we as feedback. Okay, but that sounds really nice. It was convincing to get a grant, it was convincing for ourselves to commit ourselves to this project, but at the end of the day, if you want to have clients, well, what they want to see is, of course, money, yes? Like, how can we earn money for them or save money for them? And this is a tough question. So I had to really make my numbers to discover how to convince them. I didn't, but... So the project, the cost of the project, like it's 20% is the design and construction and 80% in maintenance or operations. So if you consider like an office building that is one of the most energy demanding in the whole architecture, it needs 84 million during the life cycle for the energy. And it implies, of course, a lot of energy on the environment and all this. So let's consider this graph. And this is the change potential of the design. So this is the not optimized design. We just spent really little money on concept and planning, and then the cost goes up. But if we spend a little bit more in the concept and planning and optimize the building, we have this potential of savings within 30 times. And we calculated that it could be up to 5 million for average office building. And this is what we try to offer to developers right now. So I gave you already the example how we could reduce amount of material and reduce the cost for design and construction. Now let's have another example from our portfolio for maintenance and operation. So maintenance of the building has these numbers, and some of these numbers, like some of the energy goes for cooling. And you could reduce the amount of energy for cooling by different devices and smartly intelligent management of the building, but also by global chances of position or shape. The project was in the Mexico City. It was done with 10 architects, office building, and they asked us to manipulate the geometry of the building just a little bit. They gave us numbers, how much we could move every vertex, and not really change the shape so much. They gave us tolerance of 10%, and that was it. So optimization, some results, and if we have the from catalog the project that was had the least radiation, it was reduced by 35% in this case from the initial design, that is equal to the demand, energy demand for 20 houses. And this is just for summer energy for air conditioning for this building. It's just it. In 30 years, it's more $100,000 in the life cycle of the building. And people ask us, what can we do? And actually, this is a generic method. It could be applied to any project, in any scale, because this is what the generic optimizers do. So it depends on us, like what kind of fitness function we create. And I would like to conclude with Fry Otto's statement that we have infinite possibilities in architects don't know about, and it's not the future, it's already today. And thank you. So invite you to the machinery workshop we're going to organize in Berlin next month. So if anyone's interested in all this AI stuff, it's going to be held for 3 days before. It's right on meetup in Berlin, so it's going to be like a series of really nice events going on. So I'm inviting, and also we're leading with Thomas Wortmann masterclass at Hamburg in the International Association of Special Structures, and also after this conference, actually, I'm going to be right there. Okay.
Thank you, Judyta. I think if you guys are interested in this topic, you should go to Berlin. That is quite interesting workshop. There's also, you're doing it with Mateusz.
Tutor. So Mateusz is author of all, so also it's based on machine learning job categorization.
Yeah, I'm sure can do it. Do we have any questions for you? Yes.
At the beginning of the presentation, there was a slide where you said that you highlighted a couple of problems with evolutionary programming, and you mentioned, for instance, like when you have noisy fitness function or fitness functions that change over time. But the example that you took was just structural optimization, right?
Just structural optimization, you say, yes?
Yeah, before that.
Yeah, okay.
The building with the Japanese commentary.
Yeah.
And, when you have structural optimization, the fitness function is well defined.
This one was quite smooth, like a small landscape. If you could imagine that, because this is an 85-dimensional landscape. But it had a penalty function on it as well, so we had area that the solution doesn't exist basically. Yes, but how to say? Like for these optimizers, you need to know how to formulate the function to make it quite small. If it's noisy, actually all this AI stuff gets a little bit lost looking for the solution. And all they really learn very slow and it's not efficient. So this is up to us to be aware how to formulate this function. It requires some smooth function. Like, as Robert Geringer says, we should, when you make a small change on the slider, you should have a small change in the phenotype, so in the result. And then you could assure that these tools could help you solve that.
But, and then when you see the need for a smooth fitness function is, it's only, it's interesting to have smooth fitness functions when you have particles form because they're based on minimizing gradient of error. But
it's the same for Galapagos, it's the same for octopus game, but gradient dependence sort of like they learn the passing of attraction basically. So they need this gradient to learn.
This is all.
Yes. Okay, thank you, Lisa.